Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for coming out to the Die Hard Live Script Reading. Give yourself a round of applause for coming out and supporting local comedy, local Christmas. We have a lot of amazing people playing the roles tonight. There are too many to go over, so I'm just going to go over some of the highlights. We have Butch Wesley playing America's greatest hero, John McClane.
Hello!
And playing Germany's greatest villain, Hans Gruber, we have Logan Lotzenheiser. My boy Rand Barnacle here at the end of the front table will be taking on the daunting task of playing every single henchman. He has the wigs, he is prepared. And most importantly, you guys have a role in this because all of you are motherfucking hostages. How about it? And if, just to make sure the vibe's really there, we locked the door from the outside, so there's no escape. And we're ready to go. We ready, everybody? All right, let's do it. Cue music. Everybody. We hear the roar of an airplane as it lands in a California runway. Inside, a salesman calmly sits upright. He looks to the man next to him and smiles. John McClane, mid-30s, smiles back. He has the demeanor of a stoic outlaw and kind of looks like that guy from Die Hard 2.
You don't like flying, do you?
What gives you that idea?
You know, you want to know how the secret to surviving air travel?
Yeah.
After you get to wherever you're going, take your shoes and your socks, then walk around the rug barefoot and make fists with your toes.
Make fists with your toes?
Yeah. Yeah. I know. It sounds crazy, but trust me, I've been doing it for 9 years.
This is already better than last year's.
Yes, sir. Better than a shower and a hot cup of coffee. God damn it.
John gets up to collect his luggage from the overhead. The salesman's smile vanishes as he sees a gun is holstered to John's torso.
It's okay. I'm a cop. Trust me. I've been doing this for 11 years.
John grabs a giant teddy bear from overhead. As he heads to the exit, he bumps into a stewardess. She sizes him up and instantly falls in love with him. Love is fleeting, though, and John moves forward. As John walks to baggage claim, he lights a cigarette right in the middle of the airport. We cut to the 30th floor of the Nakatomi Plaza. Joe Takagi, a middle-aged business tycoon, looks down at the party happening below him. He smiles at the merriment and good cheer.
Ladies and gentlemen, I want to congratulate each and every one of you for making this one of the greatest years in the history of the Nakatomi Corporation.
The crowd goes wild!
Thank you. On behalf of the Chief Executive Officer, Mr. Ozu, and the Board of Directors, we wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
As the crowd proceeds with the festivities, we cut to a hallway. Holly McClane is being relentlessly pursued by Harry Ellis. Holly is confident with a strong resolve and a perm that would make Lionel Richie jealous. Harry Ellis has the unlimited arrogance and zero self-awareness. He's the kind of guy who would call his dick his Harry Ellis.
Hey, Holly, what about dinner tonight, huh?
Harry, it's Christmas Eve. Families, stockings, chestnuts. Rudolph and Frosty? Any of these things ring a bell?
Actually, I was thinking more of a mulled wine, a nice aged brie, a roaring fireplace. You know what I'm saying?
Holly turns to Ginny, her pregnant secretary. Just a pregnant secretary. Nothing weird about that.
Ginny, it's 5:40. Go join the party. Have some champagne. You're making me feel like Ebenezer Scrooge.
Thanks, Miss Gennaro. You think the baby can have a little sip?
That baby's ready to 10 bar.
Ginny exits, excited to feed her alcoholic baby. Nothing weird about that.
Last chance.
Bye.
Ellis exits. Holly picks up the phone. We cut to the McLean household. Lucy McLean and her brother, John Jr., are playing in the kitchen when the phone rings. Lucy races to the phone.
McLean residence. Lucy McLean speaking.
Well, hello, Lucy McLean. This is your mother speaking.
Mommy, when are you coming home?
Pretty soon. Pretty soon. You'll be in bed when I get there, though. Let me talk to Paulina, okay? Okay, hon? And no snooping around the house looking for presents.
Is Daddy coming home with you? Plot point.
Holly. All right, if you're going to break, I'm going to break. You're supposed to play a child girl and you sound like Dustin from Stranger Things. Before Hollywood got to him and he got the teeth. Holly looks at a picture right next to her phone. Herself, John, and the children. So happy back then.
We'll see what Santa and Mommy can do, okay? Put Paulina on. Bye, honey.
Paulina.
Paulina, a kind Latina nanny, walks over. She has resting happy face.
Oh. Hola, Miss Holly.
Did Mr. McLean call?
No, Miss Holly. No, McLean, no here. No telephone.
Well, he probably just didn't have time before his flight. Make up the spare bedroom just in case.
See, Mrs. Holly, I do that already.
What would I do without you, Paulina?
Holly hangs up the phone without even saying goodbye. She looks at the picture of her family and slams it face down. At the airport, John and his teddy bear walk towards ground transport. A young traveler runs past him and jumps into the arms of her lover, making out passionately, hotly. Some would say too hot. Some would say obnoxiously hot. Some, hey! Hey, 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 hey! You know, keep going, actually. Wait. All right, hold on. We got a show to do. We're only like 4 pages into this 80-page script, so.
Apparently, they have a show to do also.
I'm gonna need you, miss, to please leave. All right, give it up for that lady, everybody.
Woo!
California. John walks towards a gaggle of limo drivers holding signs. He sees a young man with a sign that reads J. McLean.
Hey, I'm John McLean.
Argyle, I'm your limo driver.
John sizes him up. He looks too young to even have his learner's permit.
Nice bear.
Okay, Argyle. What do we do now?
I was hoping you could tell me. This is my first time driving a limo.
That's okay. It's my first time riding in one.
We cut to the limo, cruising down a California highway.
Relax, man. We got everything in this mug, man. Look at this. CD, CB, TV, telephone, full bar, VHS. And if your friend's hot to trot, I know a couple mama bears we can hook up with.
Argyle looks at John.
Or is he married?
He's married.
Okay.
John picks up a fast food wrapper sitting at his feet.
Sorry about that. It was the girl's day off. Didn't know you were going to be sitting up front. So your lady live out here?
For the past 6 months.
Without even asking permission, John lights up another cigarette.
Meaning you still live in New York?
You always ask this many questions, Argyle?
Ha! Sorry, I used to drive a cab, man. People would expect a little chit-chat. So, you divorced?
Just drive the car, man.
Come on, you divorced, you separated, she beat you up?
She had a good job, turned into a great career.
That means she had to move here.
You're very fast, Argyle.
So why didn't you come?
John sees the Nakatomi Plaza. It is a looming figure, 40 stories tall.
Well, why didn't you come with her, man? What's up?
Because I'm a New York cop. I've got a 6-month backlog of New York scumbags I'm trying to put behind bars. I can't just pick up and go that easy.
In other words, you thought she wasn't going to make it out here, and she'd come crawling back to you.
So why bother to pack, right?
Argyle laughs right in John's fucking face.
Ha! Ha ha ha! Ha 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 ha! Oh man! Ha!
Like I said, you're very fast, Argyle.
Mind if we hear some tunes?
Argyle pops in a cassette tape. There it is.
I was thinking more like Christmas music.
This is Christmas music.
This is Christmas music, and this song is too good to end immediately, so I say it's time for a shot break, huh? How about that? Get these shots moving, thanks to our lovely staff here at the Overlook Lodge. Bump that shit. Take the mic, Phil.
A ill reindeer.
Do not drink them immediately. We're gonna toast. It wouldn't be Christmas without toasting.
Stuffing macaroni and cheese, and Santa put gifts under Christmas trees. Decorate the house with lights at night. Snow's on the ground, snow white so bright. In the fireplace is the Yule log. Beneath the mistletoe as we drink eggnog. The rhymes that we hear are the rhymes of carols. Our kitchen every year we bust Christmas carols.
Raise your hand if you do not have a shot.
I have not heard this song.
All right, well, let's see what happens. Oh, man. Run it again. Hell yeah. Hell yeah, we're running it again. All right. Let's see. Put your hand up and keep it up there if you do not have a Christmas shot. We got four people at the bar. We got two people here. Keep that hand up. And hey, while we're at it, how about a round of applause for the bartenders, huh? They are taking care of you. They are taking care of us. They're here almost every day of the week, so tip them well. This is our lives. And we're running it again. That's right. Put your hand up. Keep your hand up. Especially if you don't have a shot. Especially.
Just put it up.
All right. All right, is everyone good? All right, let's cut the music. All right, everyone, this is a beautiful holiday tradition. I want everyone to raise their glasses with me. A toast to... Ah, shit, what should we toast for?
I propose a toast.
All right, Joe Takagi, a toast.
To Nakatomi Industry. And may life be perfect and nothing ever go wrong.
Yeah! Hot dog, all righty. I don't even know where we are. Rock and roll. The limo pulls to the front of the plaza. John looks to the top as he gets out of his car.
So your lady sees you, you run into each other's arms, and you live happily ever after, right?
I can live with that.
And if this doesn't work out, you got a place to stay?
I'll find a place.
Tell you what, I'll pull into the parking garage and I'll wait. You score, you give me a call on the car phone. I'll take your bags to the desk. You strike out, I'll get you to a hotel.
John shakes Argyle's hand.
You're all right, Argyle.
Just remember that when you sign for the tip.
John closes the door without even saying goodbye. He walks up to the guards sitting at the front desk of the Nakatomi lobby.
Hi.
Good evening.
I'm here to see Holly McLean.
The guard points at a fancy touchscreen computer on the desk.
Just type it in there.
John presses the screen and a grid of lettered blocks appear.
Cute toy.
Yeah, if you have to take a leak, it'll even help you find your zipper.
John presses the M block. A series of last names starting with M appear, none of them being McLean. John returns to the home screen and presses G. He sees her name clear as day. Gennaro, Holly's maiden name.
Christ.
He presses her name, leading to a floor diagram.
13th floor, the party. They're the only ones left in the building. Take the express elevator.
Oh, do I have a line?
Yeah. It's a big one.
Why didn't you just tell me that when I walked in? Thanks.
After we watch Argyle park his car for some reason, we see John entering the party. John grabs champagne from a butler and studies the scene. He's severely underdressed. The champagne is awful. He hands it back to the butler. Suddenly, a random drunk guy runs right up to John and gives him a warm embrace.
Up. Oh, this was up.
Oh. Hey, Merry Christmas.
And just like that, he's gone.
Fucking California.
John walks up to the most professional looking guy in the room.
Hi, I'm looking for...
Holly Gennaro?
Yeah.
You must be John McLean. Joe Takagi. How was the ride in?
It was nice. I have you to thank for that.
Seemed the least we could do.
Quite a place you got here.
It will be, if we ever get it finished. There are still several floors under construction.
They walk towards Holly's office.
Holly went to the vault room to fax some documents. Should be back any minute. In the meantime, her office is right back there.
They open the door to find Harry Ellis quickly wiping cocaine off of Holly's desk.
Ah, hey, buddy. I was just using the phone.
Ellis, I want you to meet John McLean, Holly's husband. Holly's policeman. Ellis is in charge of international development.
Heard a heck of a lot about you.
John points at the desk.
You missed some.
Can I get you anything? Food? Cake? Watered down champagne?
No, thank you. I'm fine. You threw a hell of a party. Didn't realize they celebrated Christmas in Japan.
Pearl Harbor didn't work out, so we got you with tape decks.
Ellis laughs his famous laugh.
Actually, it's a part of a double celebration. It's sort of a double celebration. We closed a pretty big deal today, and a lot of that had to do with Holly. Am I right, JoJo?
Holly walks in, documents in hand. She sees John, and her face lights up.
John!
She walks up to hug him. He gives her a light kiss on the cheek.
Have you met everyone?
We've been sticking him with Spears. She was made for the business, John. Tough as nails.
I was hoping you made that flight.
Show him the watch.
Later.
Well, go on, show him. What are you embarrassed for? It's just a small token of appreciation for her hard work. It's a Rolex.
I'm sure I'll see it later. Is there a place I can wash up?
Sure.
We cut to outside as a large semi-truck heads towards Nakatomi. We cut back to Holly and John, alone.
You have to forgive Ellis. He gets very depressed around this time of year. He always, though, he was I'm going to say thought on that one. He always thought he was God's greatest gift, you know?
I know the type. I think he's got his eye on you.
That's okay. I've got eyes on his private bathroom. Where are you staying? Things happened so fast. I didn't think to ask.
Cappy Roberts retired out here. He told me I could bunk with him.
Cappy Roberts retired? Where does he live?
Ramona.
Ha, Pomona.
Huh?
Pomona.
Pomona.
Pomona?
Haro. Pomona?
Pomona.
Ramona.
Pomona.
Pomona.
Pomona. Yeah, you'll be in the car half the time. Why don't we just make it easy? I have a spare bedroom. It's not huge or anything. But the kind would... What the fuck? I can...
Would I be going too far to say that wig's getting in the way of your face?
I disagree. It's helping. It's not huge or anything, but the kids would love to have you at the house.
They would, huh?
I would, too.
Just as things are getting sentimental, a man and woman throw the door open, ready to fuck heavily on their boss's desk. Passionately. Obnoxiously. Gross. Unsanitary. They travel now? What the... It's an airborne thing? Oh.
They travel.
All right, I want to see how long they can do this for, everybody. Seeing Holly, they quickly apologize and walk back out. Give it up for that stranger again, everybody. And we turn the page.
I missed you.
Guess you didn't miss my name, though, huh? Except maybe when you're signing checks. Since when did you start using Miss Gennaro?
It's a Japanese company. They figured a married woman's...
You are a married woman, Holly. You're married to me.
Are we really going to have this conversation? We did this in July.
We never finished this conversation in July.
I had an opportunity that I had to take.
No matter what the consequences were for our marriage.
It didn't do anything to our marriage except change your idea of what it
should
be. You
have no clue what my idea of a marriage is.
I know exactly your idea of what our marriage should be.
Just then, Ginny bursts through the door, immediately sensing the tension.
Miss Gennaro, Mr. Sakagi is looking for you. He wants you to say something to the troops.
Speech time. Be back in a few minutes.
Holly and Ginny exit. John, stewing in his anger, bangs the side of his head on the door frame. He looks at the mirror.
That was great, John. Good job. Very mature.
It's dark outside. We see a truck pull into the Nakatomi parking garage, as well as a car pulling up to the front of the building. The security guard is watching TV as two people walk to his desk. One is a computer hacker named Theo. The other is Carl. It's Carl with a K, so he's definitely foreign.
So Kareem has the ball, right? He feeds it to Worthy, over to AC, then to Magic, then back to Worthy, and...
Carl takes out a pistol and shoots the guard right in the face.
Boom! 2 points! And can I be honest? I'm starting to think you don't even care about basketball.
And with the guard being dead, that's a wrap for Billy, everybody! Give it up for Billy! Billy DeVore, everybody! Hand those over to him! Yeah, give him a big round.
Billy!
Billy!
Billy! Billy! Billy! Billy! Billy! Billy!
All right, get the fuck out.
Billy sits back down. Theo jumps over the desk, kicks the guard to the floor, and pulls out a radio.
We are in.
The truck driver nods as he puts his radio down. This truck pack, its back panel slides open, revealing 12 armed men, all being led by Hans Gruber. Hans is cold and calculating. His haircut is slick, and his suit is even slicker. I'd say he's the coolest German since Adolf Hitler. Theo is on a computer, typing away like a madman. He locks the building down and stops all but one elevator. Hans and his gang enter the lobby. One henchman named Eddie steals the guard's jacket for a disguise. Theo is just kicking stuff and ripping wires to make sure nothing works. Hans is calmly surveying everything. A taller henchman with glasses paces through the basement looking for phone lines. We cut back to John, freshening up in Ellis's suite. His feet are now bare.
Son of a bitch. Fist with your toes.
He pulls Argyle's card out of his wallet and picks up the phone.
Hey, Argyle.
Hey, man. How's it going up there?
All right. Where are you?
Argyle's chilling in the limo with John's teddy bear.
I'm kicking it down here in the garage. What's the deal with you and your lady, man?
Vote's not in yet.
Suddenly, the phone line cuts off.
Argyle.
Mac, you there? Hello?
Argyle hangs up.
You know the number. Use it.
We cut to the elevator. As Hans and his gang load up their machine guns, we reach the 30th floor. They calmly enter the party, noticed by absolutely nobody. John hangs up his phone just as he hears gunfire outside. This gunfire is immediately followed by the panicked cries of the Nakatomi employees! John grabs his gun and peers out of the door. The terrorists round up employees, including Holly. Just as a guard is approaching John's room, he turns away. By the time another man enters, John is gone. We see John's bare feet barreling up a stairwell. Back at the party, Hans surveys the chaos he's created. Ellis has picked a bad day to be on coke.
Oh, stay calm, stay calm. Everything's gonna be fine.
John reaches the 32nd floor. It's under construction. John runs through, never letting his guard down. He picks up a phone and slams it down, realizing all the lines are cut.
Shit! Shit! Think! Think!
On the 10th floor, Hans... On the 30th floor, Hans raises one hand.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Excuse me. I meant to say ladies and gentlemen.
The crowd hushes. Hans reads from a tiny black notebook.
Due to the Nakatomi Corporation's legacy of greed around the globe, they're about to learn a lesson in the real use of power. You will witness this. Now, where is Mr. Takagi?
Takagi tries to raise his hand, but Holly holds his arm down.
Don't move.
Joseph Yoshinobu Takagi. Born in Kyoto, 1937. Family integrated to Southern California, 1939. Interned 1942 to 1943. Scholarship student, University of California. 1955. Law degree from Stanford, 1962. MBA from Harvard, 1970. I really like dates. President of Nakatomi Trading, Vice Chairman of Nakatomi Investment Group. Need I go on?
Enough!
Takagi rises defiantly.
And father of five.
Is that me? I am Takagi.
I know.
Are you sure?
First name's Joe.
Hans somehow smiles with only his upper lip.
How do you do? It's a pleasure to meet you.
Two henchmen pull Takagi out of the room. There is a wave of concern among the crowd. He's in trouble. John is running up the stairs looking for any floors that could be of any help to him.
32, construction. 33, computers.
Back in the elevator, Takagi stands solemnly while Hans hums a little Christmas tune.
It's an old German tune. You might not recognize it. Nice suit, John Phillips London. I have two myself.
The elevator door opens.
Rumor has it, Arafat buys his there. Ah!
Yeah! Sick burn if you know who Arafat is. John peers through the door of the 35th floor and sees two terrorists hauling what looks like plastic explosives. That's because they are plastic explosives. He quickly shuts the door and heads back down the stairs. Hans and Takagi walk through Takagi's office, surveying the scale models of Takagi architecture.
And when Alexander saw the breadth of his domain, he wept, for there were no more worlds to conquer. Benefits of a classical education,
A model of a bridge catches Hans' eye. He is impressed to a sarcastic degree.
Oh, that is beautiful. I always enjoyed making models as a young boy. The exactness, the attention to every conceivable detail. It's beautiful.
So what's this all about? Our project in Indonesia? Contrary to what you people think, we're going to develop that region, not exploit it.
Just then, John enters the room, but is far away and quiet enough to go unnoticed.
I read your article in Forbes, Mr. Takagi. I could talk about industrialization and men's fashions all day. But I'm afraid work must intrude, and my associate here has some questions for you. Some fill-in-the-blank questions.
Hans leads Takagi to Theo, who is hard at work on his Nakatomi vault.
You broke in here to access our computer? Any information you could get, they'll wake up in Tokyo in the morning and they'll change it. You won't be able to blackmail our executives or threaten...
Sit down!
Takagi sits. Good boy.
I'm already sitting. Mr. Takagi... Oh, that's not me.
That is your name, yes. I'm not really interested in your computer, but I need the code because I am interested in the 640 million in negotiable bearer bonds you have locked in your vault.
You
and
want
the computer
money?
Controls the vault. Wow.
What kind of terrorists are you?
Who said we were terrorists?
John moves across the room. He continues to watch the negotiation from underneath the bridge model. Hans now has a pistol, which he is attaching a silencer to.
Now, the code, please.
It's useless to you. There are 7 safeguards to our vault, and the code key is only one of them. You'll never get it open.
Then there's no reason not to tell it to us. That's a very nice suit, Mr. Takagi. It'd be a shame to ruin it. Now I'm going to count to 3. There will not be a 4. Give me the code. 1, 2, 3.
I don't know it! I'm telling you, get on a goddamn jet to Tokyo and ask the chairman. You'll just have to kill me.
Okay.
Blam! Hans shoots Takagi right in the head, painting the wall with blood.
We'll do it the hard way, Tony. See if you can dispose of that. Carl, you better check on Heinrich's work on the machine floor.
John, racked with shock, makes his move out of the room. Hans and his goons all hear him. They draw their weapons and proceed warily. They find no sign of him. Hans looks to Theo.
Now, can you break the code?
You didn't bring me for my charming personality.
Oh.
Or, did you? Did I?
I'm a little bit.
Did I misread this? Is there something happening here? You and me, maybe?
Is there a thing going on?
I feel like there might be a thing going on.
There's a thing going on.
We'll see.
All right.
Yeah, I mean,
look at that.
John, who hid himself inside of Takagi's office, takes a moment to catch his breath.
Argyle, tell me you heard the shots. You're calling the police right now, right?
Argyle hasn't done a thing. We catch him in the middle of a phone call.
Of course I'm still coming over later, sweetheart. Have I ever lied to you? Oh, my boss? He thinks I'm on my way to Vegas.
As henchmen and Stides start planting the explosives, Theo fills Hans in on the details.
30 minutes to break the code, 2 hours, 2.5 hours. For the 5 mechanicals. The 7th lock, however, is out of my hands.
I'm sorry?
That's sweet of you. The 7th lock, the electromagnetic seal, you do understand circuits can't be cut locally, right?
Trust me.
Up on floor 32, John is pacing back and forth.
Why the fuck didn't you stop him, John? Because you'd be dead and dead. Asshole thing, goddammit.
He looks up and sees a sprinkler system. He looks to his left to find a fire alarm. Down in the lobby, Eddie, the henchman, sees a distress signal from that floor. He pulls out his radio.
We got a fire alarm.
That is one of 6 henchmen Rand will be playing today. Hans interjects.
Call 911. Give them the guard's name, the building code number, and cancel the alarm. Then disable the system. Eddie, on what floor did the alarm go off?
Up on John's floor, John rejoices as police cars and fire trucks head towards the building.
Yes! Oh, baby, come to Papa. Come on. Come on, baby, come. I'll kiss your fucking Dalmatian.
Slowly, one by one, the cars turn off their lights, turn around, and head towards the horizon.
Ah, you stupid motherfuckers. No, no, turn the fucking truck around.
John hears something, but more likely it's someone. A henchman named Tony appears, machine gun in hand. John hides behind a desk as Tony turns on the lights. Tony knows he's not alone.
The fire alarm has been called off, my friend. No one...
I can't do a German accent. I realize half of these people are goddamn Germans.
Hey, Christmas is a time for miracles, buddy. Plow through.
The fire alarm has been called off, my friend.
They're good.
No one is coming to help you.
It comes in and out. English is a second language.
You might as well come out and join the others. I promise I won't hurt you.
Guys, we're only a quarter of the way through this goddamn movie. This is ridiculous. We'll find it. Tony jumps behind the desk and unloads a round of bullets, all hitting the floor. Suddenly, we hear the whir of a buzzsaw coming from the other side. Tony walks wearily towards the noise. By the time he reaches the saw, though, it has come to a complete stop. Before Tony can turn, John has a pistol to his temple.
Drop it, dickhead.
You won't hurt me.
It's the police.
Because you're a policeman, there are rules for policemen.
Yeah? That's what my captain keeps telling me.
John whacks Tony with a forearm and jumps on his back. Tony backs into a wall, forcing John to drop his pistol. John puts Tony in a headlock. Tony drops the gun and starts ramming John's head through some drywall. Tony backs up and they fall down a flight of stairs. As they hit the bottom, Tony's neck is snapped and he's killed instantly. John shoves Tony's body off and takes a second to catch his breath. We see Theo unlocking the vault code, Red Castle. He gains access to the first lock. The screen reads, "Do you wish to proceed?"
You bet your sweet ass I wish to proceed.
He puts on his goggles and starts up a giant drilling mechanism. Back at the stairwell, John searches through Tony's bags. He finds ammo, a lighter, and a radio. He struggles to put on Tony's shoes.
A million terrorists in the world, and I kill the one with feet smaller than my sister's.
As he shoves Tony's corpse into the elevator, he sees a plastic Santa in the corner. This gives him an idea. Back at the party, Hans is sitting calmly. Several henchmen have their guns pointed at the crowd of hostages.
I wanted this to be professional, efficient, adult, and cooperative. Not a lot to ask. Alas, your Mr. Takagi did not see it that way. So he will not be joining us for the rest of his life. Burn.
God, real good.
We can go any way you want. You can walk out of here or you can be carried out. So have no illusions. We are in charge. And so decide now, each of you. Please remember, we have left nothing to chance.
One of the hostages screams as the elevator opens. Tony sits with a bloody red face and a bloody red Santa hat. Some henchmen rush to the elevator while some guard the curious hostages.
Get them back!
Hans looks at Tony's sweater. There's a message written on it.
Now I have a machine gun. How?
Perhaps a security guard we overlooked?
Security guard? They're usually tired and burned out older policemen growing fat on pension. This is... something else, like a ghost.
As Hans and Fritz converse in German, we see John is peering down from the roof of the elevator car. Our hero is only 4 feet from our villain.
We have to do something, Hans.
I know, that ghost has a machine gun. We have to tell Carl that his brother is dead. Tell him to come down.
The elevator car starts going up, all the way to the top floor. John ducks just in time so that he's not crushed to death by the ceiling. In Hans's temporary office, Carl is throwing stuff and flipping tables. Something says he didn't take his brother's death well.
I want blood.
Well, I can get it for you. But let Heinrich plant the detonators and Theo prepare the vault. After, we call the police. They'll waste hours trying to negotiate, and then you can tear the building apart looking for this man. But until then, we do not alter the plan.
And what if he alters it, Hans?
For once, Hans has no answer. Amongst the hostages, Ellis and Holly observe Hans and Carl losing their cool.
So, what do you think's up with that?
Something's wrong.
Cops?
John.
John, ah, Christ, he'll fuck this whole thing up. What does he think he's doing?
His job.
Oh, bullshit. His job's 3,000 miles away. Without him, we'll still have a chance to get out of here alive or something.
Tell that to Takaki.
Jesus Christ, that's way too soon.
Is it?
A sharp cut to John running up some stairs, machine gun in hand. He ends up on the roof, looking out at the lights of California. After making sure the coast is clear, he pulls out the CB radio.
Mayday, mayday, anyone copy? Channel 9.
Inside, Carl hears John's voice on the radio. It catches Hans's attention as well.
Terrorists have seized the Nakatomi building and are holding at least 30 people hostage. I repeat, different words. Unknown number of terrorists, 6 or more, armed with automatic weapons at Nakatomi Plaza, Century City.
Best place to transmit? Oh, the roof!
Somebody answer me, goddammit!
Go, go!
Jesus Christ. Carl bursts out of the room. Two 911 dispatchers are reviewing the distress signal from Nakatomi.
I'll handle it. Attention, whoever you are, this is a channel reserved for emergency calls only.
No fucking shit, lady! Do I sound like I'm ordering a pizza?
In the elevator, Carl, Fritz, and a henchman named Franco are getting their guns ready. Carl has death in his eyes.
No one kills him but me.
This is so much better than last year's. John is still on the roof, screaming into his radio.
They've already killed one hostage. They're fortifying their positions while you're jerking me off on the radio.
Sir, I've already told you, this is a reserved channel. This is an emergency call. Dial 911 on your telephone that you have. Otherwise, I'll report this as an FCC violation.
Fine, report me. Come the fuck down here and arrest me. Just send the fucking police now.
Machine gun fire. It barely misses John, who takes off like a horse. He slides down to the other side of the roof, narrowly avoiding the bullet shower. The gunfire is so loud, the dispatchers remove their earpieces.
We'll see if there's a black and white who can do a drive-by.
We cut to a local gas station. A cop named Al Powell grabs 8 or 9 Hostess Twinkies. He kind of looks like that cop from Family Matters. That cop from Turner and Hooch. That cop from Ghostbusters. That cop from one specific episode of Girl Meets World. And of course, that cop from Die Hard 2. He carries his Twinkies to the cashier, much like our Gorilla Cinnamon employees are carrying Twinkies to you right fucking now. How about that, huh?
Oh, no way.
All righty. Let's see. Where were we?
I thought you guys were supposed to eat donuts.
Yeah, they're for me and my wife to celebrate our spinoff. You know.
Yeah.
From Perfect Strangers, Cousin Balky, Cousin Larry, fucking Generation Xers.
Yeah.
Yeah. Also, she's pregnant.
Yeah.
Should we just wait a second? All right.
No.
Okay.
Yes. All right, we're going to wait until, we're going to do this again. We're going to toast with Twinkies this time. We're setting new traditions every time. All right.
Yeah, that's a fast one.
Actually, me too.
And me too. I want a panther. I'll get him a there
it is. Are we also going to end this with real explosions?
Hit me!
That'll be fun. Thanks, big squeeze.
Red baby!
Oh, I don't.
Will one?
These are all.
Dad?
looks at fucked your mom. Almost. How old are you?
What?
20 something years ago.
Oh my god. Hey.
Oh, those who wait. Carl, on a loose cannon.
Time to catch up on social media.
Oh, thank you, Mr. McLean.
All right.
Yeah.
Huh? According to the script about my mother.
Look, I don't know that person.
Raise your hand if you do not have a Twinkie.
Yeah.
All right.
Huh? You gotta save it for I open a Twinkie. Get these crackers.
All right, everyone. It is toast time again. I want you to raise those Twinkies to the air. Loud and proud in a Christmas tradition. A toast. What should we... Joe Takagi, what should we toast to?
I'm dead.
All right, to Joe Takagi, everybody. May he rest in peace.
Rest in peace, Joe.
Al Powell then proceeds to eat 4 Twinkies in one bite.
Are we there yet?
Yeah, we're there yet. Eat them, buddy.
We're there. Here we go.
We have to figure out a way to get these people's attention back. You have to eat 4 Twinkies in one bite.
Yeah.
Come on. Phil. One more, Phil. Come on, buddy. Come on. It's like Ferris. You got to clap if you believe in him. Come on. Yeah. That is how you do it. Franco and Fritz are chasing John around the roof. Who is saying wait? Okay.
Thank you, sir.
All righty. Here we go. Franco and Fritz are chasing John around the roof. They are backing him into Carl, who is approaching from the top of the roof. They shoot John into a corner. He reloads his machine gun and shoots the hinges off a door leading inside. John uses his machine gun to stop a giant turbine fan. The henchmen catch up to him just as he gets through it. He then climbs down a ladder that leads to the building's elevator shafts. The henchmen can't find a way to get through the fan. As John passes through one hallway, there are some pictures of naked ladies on the wall. John quickly paws at their bosoms.
Ladies.
Love is fleeting, though, and John moves forward. He busts open a window that leads him to an elevator shaft.
Oh, my God.
Meanwhile, Fritz and Carl are talking to Hans on the radio.
He's in the elevator shaft. Hans, you hear that?
Perfect. The elevators are locked off so he can't escape. Shut him in and come back down.
John starts descending the shaft.
Ah, fuck.
Carl, the police are probably on their way. Already? Carl!
John rappels the elevator shaft. His rope is strong, but the machine gun it's tied up to doesn't look sturdy enough to hold his weight. Hans is still mad as we hear through Fritz's radio.
I can stall them, but not if they hear gunshots. If you lock him in, he'll be neutralized and...
Carl shuts off the radio.
Motherfucker.
John is now straining to swing from one end of the shaft to another. He's reaching towards an air duct, but he can feel the machine gun bending. The rope snaps off of the gun. John falls two stories and barely grabs onto the edge of a lower air duct. John slowly but surely crawls into the air duct. It's cramped, but he's sweaty, so it's kind of perfect. John decides this is a perfect time to mock his wife.
Come out to the coast. We'll get together. Have a few laughs.
John starts to crawl. It is a squeaky struggle.
Now I know what a TV dinner feels like.
Carl, Fritz, and Franco frantically run into separate rooms, all with air ducts right above them. They keep their guns up and their ears open. John, who can see through the ventilation, does everything he can to be quiet. He needs to keep quiet because Carl has a machine gun pointed right in his direction. Suddenly, Carl unleashes a rain of gunfire into the ventilation. Fortunately, he shoots the wrong side of the duct. The bullets miss John, who somehow remains perfectly still. Carl starts pushing the barrel of his gun into the vent to see if anything metal will bend. John is loading his pistol. Carl is right underneath John. He's about to poke his gun right into John's stomach when Fritz calls him over.
Auschwitz, Adolf Hitler, 9/11.
That's German real gibberish. German. Yeah. That is real German. Carl reluctantly walks away. John is safe for now. We cut to Al driving his car to the tower. At the top, there's an armed henchman watching him park. In an unidentified office, we see John climb in through the ceiling. His feet are disgusting, and his undershirt has gone from pure white to pure brown. Fun fact, this undershirt is currently in the Smithsonian. In between the first teddy bear and the hat that Lincoln died in. As Al is parking, John investigates the office where Takagi died. Out the window, he sees Al.
It's about time.
Al pulls out his radio.
No sign of disturbance, dispatch.
AO39, Roger. Possible crank call. Check the area again and confirm.
John watches in confusion and sees Al's car repeatedly circling the parking lot.
Who's driving this car? Stevie Wonder?
Is that racist? Argyle.
Look.
Argyle, is that racist?
Don't put this on me.
Okay.
Don't put this on me.
All right.
You man. Casted me.
Al is peering into the window of the lobby.
Well, I do see a guard inside. Better go in and take a closer look.
AO30, Roger, use caution. I am the least interesting character in this film.
Hans is also looking at Al's car from above. He pulls out his radio.
Eddie
responds, now with a thick southern accent.
I had a feeling you'd call.
As Al walks towards the front door, Eddie opens it for him.
Evening, officer. What can I do you for?
Carl, Fritz, and Franco are running through a dark packaging room. They see Al's car from the window. Eddie walks back to his desk as Al surveys the area.
Yeah, we had that false alarm. If you ask me, it's that damn computer system sent you on a... I know it's wild goose chase. Another wild goose chase. They haven't even changed the bugs in this system ever since they installed it.
Eddie slaps his desk as he looks at the TV.
Aw, come on, shit. I got $50 on riding on that damn old game.
He is watching a daytime football game in the middle of the night. Nothing weird about that. John is still looking through the window.
Come on, where's the fucking cavalry?
He runs to grab a chair from behind him. With all of his might, he swings it at the window. One of the legs knocks out a tiny hole. The sound of glass breaking catches the attention of the rooftop gunman. This gunman radios John's whereabouts to two henchmen named Marco and Heinrich. They spring into action. As Eddie is watching the football game at his desk, Al is starting to think he's wasting his time.
You don't mind if I take a look around, do you?
Oh, no. Phil, help yourself. Al, help yourself.
Where the hell are you from, Texas or Louisiana?
Both.
Okay.
John is swinging at the window repeatedly. Each swing cracks the glass, but it is yet to break. Marco runs in with his machine gun. John pulls out his pistol.
Freeze, motherfucker, drop it! Put the fucking gun down! Put it down!
I got too psyched up.
Put your gun down.
Let's run it back.
Put it down!
Heinrich slides up from behind Marco. You are also Heinrich.
Marco, Doc!
That could be any nationality.
That's Borat.
Heinrich aims for John, but John is quick. Running backwards, he puts two bullets in Heinrich's chest. There's an inexplicably long line of tables in this office. John crawls under them as Marco jumps on top of them. Back on the ground floor, we see Al walking towards the elevator. Around the corner, just out of his view, is another armed henchman. Just as he's about to turn the corner...
Ah, to hell with this.
Al turns around and heads to the exit. Upstairs, Marco has gone wild. He's laughing and screaming like a maniac. He's firing shots on both sides of the table to keep John underneath. They eventually reach the end of the tables.
You are gone, no more table. Where you going, cop?
Marco loads up his machine gun.
Next time you have a chance to kill someone, don't hesitate.
I'm sorry.
Why are you looking at them? Why are you not looking at me when you see them?
I'm sorry.
Thank you.
That was so Spanish.
Yeah, way better than
I don't know how German people yell.
John does not hesitate. He fires a round of bullets through the table into Marco's groin. Marco dies from groin trauma.
Thanks for the advice.
Downstairs, Al is saying goodbye.
Sorry I wasted your time.
No problem at all, Al.
Happy Kwanzaa.
And to you, sir. Obviously.
John runs back to... Jesus Christ. John runs back to the window upstairs and sees Al walking back to his car.
Ah, for the love of God.
John looks at the window. He looks at Marco's corpse. Outside of the car, Al picks up his radio.
Hey, Blinken 30 to dispatch.
AO 30, go ahead.
Yeah, it's a wild goose chase over here in Nakatomi Plaza. Everything here is okay, over.
He gets into his car. Just as the door closes, a body falls onto the car.
God damn it, Jesus H. Christ!
He puts the car in reverse and prays to his God. Carl, Fritz, and Franco start unloading their bullets onto Al's car, but he's too fast. John is smugly watching the chaos unfold.
Welcome to the party, pal.
Al's backwards squad car careens over a hilltop and passes Argyle's limo. Argyle's on the phone, too busy to notice.
Get down here now, goddammit! Get Steve Urkel, Eddie, all of them! Automatic gunfire to Nakatomi! I'm requesting backup! Call some motherfucking body! Get back up and need assistance now!
Al's car barrels down the street.
Now, goddammit! Now!
Al's car finally stops when it crashes through a fence and settles in the grass below. We cut to a news station. Beat journalist and smug asshole Richard Thornburg is on the phone with a woman.
Monica, I can get us a table. Wolfgang and I are very close friends. I interviewed him, for God's sake.
Shoot, where am I? All right, there we go. The newsroom's dispatch radio crackles to life.
In the Nakatomi Plaza, they're turning my car into switch motherfucking cheese. I need backup assistance now. Now, goddammit, now!
Richard stands straight up. Finally, a story. We see dozens of police cars filing into the Nakatomi parking lot. Inside, amongst the hostages, Ellis is smiling.
I never thought I'd love to hear that sound.
In Hans's temporary office, we see him consoling his henchmen.
All of you relax. This is a matter of inconvenient timing. That's all. Police action was inevitable.
Inevitable?
Huh? Inevitable. English is my second language, thank you. In fact, it's necessary, so let them fumble about outside and stay calm. This is simply the beginning.
There is feedback from Hans's radio. He quickly grabs it.
I thought I told you all I want radio silence until further notice.
Oh, well, I'm very sorry, Hans. I'm afraid I didn't get that message.
Hans's face drops just a little bit.
Are you done? Yeah, you're done. Then it's my turn. Maybe you should have put it on the bulletin board. Maybe since I waxed Tony and Marco and his friend here, I figured you and Carlo and Carl and Franco might be a little lonely.
I feel
thought
like
I'd
you,
give you a call.
I feel like there was a couple extra people in there, but
no.
I never met Carlo before.
I can't fucking say one thing wrong, man.
Rand, what does Carlo sound like?
I remember when I got shot in the dick.
Hans interjects.
What a flashback that was. It's very kind of you. I assume you are a mysterious party crasher. You are most troublesome for a security guard?
John is searching Heinrich's body for ammo and other goods.
Sorry, Hans. Wrong guess. Would you like to double jeopardy where the stakes are double and the scores really change?
He finds a pack of cigarettes.
Well, these are very bad for you.
I don't know what you're talking about. That's a visual reference I missed. Who are you, then?
John lights a cigarette.
Just another fly in the ointment, Hans. A monkey in the wrench? A pain in the ass.
What? It's a stupid phrase, yes. Monkey in the wrench. We went over this. He reaches into Heinrich's bag to find C4 explosives. Hans puts the radio down and points to Carl and Franco.
Check on all the others. Don't use the radio. There's a guy talking about monkeys and richens on there. It doesn't make any sense. See if he's lying about Marco or Carlos and find out if anyone else is missing.
Hans gets back on the radio.
Mr. Mystery Guest.
We see John walking through a dining room.
Are you still there?
Yeah, I'm still here. Unless you want to open the front door for me.
I'm afraid not. But you have me at a loss. You know my name, but who are you? Just another American who saw too many movies as a child? Another orphan of a bankrupt culture who thinks he's John Wayne? Rambo? Marshall Dillon?
I was always kind of partial to roast beef.
Oh.
Say
Roy
that,
Rogers,
say, yeah, Roy
actually.
Rogers, thank you.
I really like those sequin shirts.
Yeah, I know, but I fucking wanted to do it. Shut up.
Do you?
We get back on track in 3, 2.
Do you really think you have a chance against us, Mr. Cowboy?
Yippee-ki-yay, motherfucker.
Man, oh man. Back at the news studio, Thornburg is yelling at his producer.
I can get the jump over everyone else. Sam, look, I'm begging you.
Simon's already out doing a remote on a Santa thing. I'll tell him to swing by or something.
I'm not sitting on this.
I don't want to hear it.
It's my story. I'm going out there. All right, look, Sam, I'll tell you what. If you don't want to give me a truck, I'll go and steal a truck.
Harvey, the news anchor, decides to chime in.
Give us a break, Thornburg.
Eat it, Harvey!
Harvey is shaken to his core. Right as the show goes live, he is sitting in dead air.
Good evening. This is Harvey Johnson.
And I'm Gail Rollins. This is the news at 10.
And that's a wrap for the news team, everybody. Give it up for the news team. Nailed it. And he's just like that, he's gone. All right.
That guy kissed me.
Thornburg looks at his producer. He's about to get on his knees and beg.
Take truck number 5. Get out of here.
Back at the plaza, we see Carl, Fritz, and Franco running into Hans's office. Where did my henchman go? Why aren't you talking right now? What the fuck are you doing? I'm not trying to be a diva, but I've got a bunch of hostages here. I'm willing to shoot anyone in the face.
He wasn't lying about Marco. He's down on the street.
I can't find it.
It's right here.
Oh, my God.
The other man is Heinrich. His bag is missing.
He had the detonators.
Hans picks up the radio.
Theo? Theo?
We hear the Theo yelling over the sound of a giant drill.
Hey, you.
We have some problems. How's the schedule?
Three down, four to go.
Then don't waste time talking to me unless you want to.
Well, you called me, so.
As soon as Hans is about to put his radio down, it crackles back to life.
This is Sergeant Carl Powell. Shit. I mean, Al Winslow. Fuck. I mean, Al Powell, Los Angeles Police Department. If the person who radioed us me for help can hear me on this channel, acknowledge this transmission. I say again, if the person who radioed for help can hear me, acknowledge this transmission.
Upstairs, we see John walking wearily through an office, machine gun in hand. He picks up the radio.
I read you, pal. Ow, pow, my pow, ow, pow, 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 ow, pow, my ow, pow,
okay,
pow.
Shit.
I didn't write any of that down.
Yeah, this is what's left of him. Can you identify yourself?
Not now. Maybe later. Listen fast, this is a party line, and the neighbors have itchy trigger fingers, all right? Here's the deal. You've got 30 or so hostages on the 30th floor. The leader's name is Hans.
We see Hans listening in on his radio. He's calming down one of his henchmen.
I'm waiting for the FBI to arrive. Until then, he can waste as much time as he likes. But we must find the bag, Fritz. Go get Uli. We must have the detonators.
John is pacing through a floor full of cubicles and offices.
They have missiles, automatic weapons, and enough plastic explosives to orbit Arnold Schwarzenegger. They're down to 9, counting this guy you just met. These guys are mostly European, judging from their clothing labels and cigarettes. They're all well-financed and very slick, I gotta say.
Well, now, how do you know that?
I've seen enough phony IDs in my time. I recognize that the ones they got must have cost them a fortune. Add all that up, and I don't know what the fuck it means. But we've got some badass perpetrators, and they're here to stay.
John lights up a cigarette.
I hear you, partner. Well, LA's finest are on it. We've taken time out of shooting black men, so light them up if you got them.
You know what you did to that kid, right? Way ahead of you, partner.
So what do I call you?
Al, you can call me Roy.
Well, listen up, Roy. If you think of anything else we need to know, let us know. In the meantime, I want you to find a safe place and hold up and let us do our job. You understand?
They're all yours, Al.
Outside, we see a slick black Cadillac pull up right next to Al's wrecked car. There are police everywhere now. Chief Dwayne Robinson gets out of the Cadillac, immediately holding up his badge.
All right, who's talking to him?
I am, sir. Sergeant Winslow, pow, shit, ow, pow.
Dwayne Robinson, pow. Now, what's the deal here? What do these pricks want?
Well, if you mean the terrorists, sir, we don't know, we don't exactly know. We haven't heard a peep from them.
Well, who the hell have you been talking to?
We don't know that either, sir. He won't give us his name, but he appears to be the one who phoned in the report. He's killed one terrorist for sure, and he claims he capped off 2 others.
Oh, he claims, pal. Has it occurred to you that he could just be one of the terrorists pulling your chain or some nutcase in there?
I don't think so, sir. In fact, I think he's a cop. Maybe not LAPD, but he's definitely killed a Negro.
How do you know that?
Just a hunch. Things he said, like being able to spot a phony ID.
Jesus Christ, pal! He could be a fucking bartender for all we know.
Speaking of which, give it up for the bartenders again, everybody! Heather Lynn and Josh! Running this whole place like it's nothing. Tip them well at the end and make sure your ID is real or they'll fucking kill you. Al and Dwayne turn to see Thornburg's TV news van pulling up at top speed.
Oh, shit.
Back in Hans's office, Fritz sets up a portable TV and turns it to the news. At the same time, Holly walks up to Hans's desk.
I have a request.
Hans doesn't even look up at her.
What idiot put you in charge? A woman?
you did when you murdered my boss.
Oh! Oh! Shit! Ah! Goddamn!
Full of burns.
Now everyone's looking to me. Personally, I'd pass on the job. I don't enjoy being this close to you.
Go on.
We have a pregnant woman out there. Relax, she isn't due for a couple of weeks. But sitting on that rock isn't doing her back any good. So I'd like permission to move her to one of the offices where there's a sofa.
No, but I'll have a sofa brought out to you. Good enough?
Good enough. And unless you like it messy, I'd start bringing us in groups to the bathroom. We'd be shitting.
Yeah. You're right, it will be done. Anything else?
Holly looks behind Hans. The picture of her, John, and the kids is still face down.
No, thank you.
Mr. Takagi chose his people well, Mrs.
Gennaro. Miss Gennaro.
Holly exits. Hans turns on the TV, which shows an overhead shot of Nakatomi Plaza.
This is Richard Thornburg live from Century City. Tonight, Los Angeles has joined the sad and worldwide fraternity of cities whose only requirement is to suffer the anguish of international terrorism.
We see Argyle in the back of the limo. The news is playing on the limo TV while he drinks from the minibar.
Apparently, 2 hours ago, an unidentified group of men seized control of the Nakatomi building, sealing off all entrances and exits.
This catches Argyle's attention.
All telephone lines have been cut, and the only communication now possible has been through the use of CB communication, which the group apparently thought brought with them.
Argyle takes a long drink. He picked the wrong day to start driving limos. He bolts to the front of the car and turns on the CB radio.
Unit 5, hold your position at the main entrance.
Back outside, dozens upon dozens of police officers are moving into place, ready to attack.
What's going on?
What does it look like? We're moving in.
Going in? Man, that's crazy. There could be over 30 hostages in there for all we know.
We don't know shit, pal. If there's hostages, how come no one's come to us with ransom demands? If there's terrorists in there, where's their list of demands? All we know is that somebody shot your car up. It's probably the same silly son of a bitch you've been talking to on that radio.
Excuse me, sir, but what about that motherfucker that fell out the window?
Yeah, I don't know about that one. It was probably like a stockbroker or something like that. Got depressed. Who gives a shit?
Dwayne looks over to one of the other cops.
All right, light him up.
The police cars turn on lights from every side of the building. Upstairs, John sees the lights going on. He picks up his radio.
Pow, 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 pow. Ow, you still with me? Babe?
I'm what? Here, Roy, but I'm kind of busy right now. I'll talk to you later.
Ow, what's wrong? What's going on, buddy?
I said I'll talk to you later. Roy, if you are who I think you are, you'll know when to listen, when to shut the fuck up, and when to pray.
Jesus Christ, you're coming in. That's it, isn't it? Christ, pal. I told you what kind of people we're dealing with here.
In his office, we see Hans looking down at the police officers. He pulls out his radio.
They'll be coming. Everyone get ready. Theo, you're the eyes now, and what eyes those are.
Man. Oh, man. It's cuffing season, everybody. The police run straight at the building. Hardly a subtle attack plan.
Shit!
As they're moving in, one of the officers screams, having been pricked by a thorny flower that he walks past. It's the funniest moment in all of film. Down by the lobby, we see Eddie and a henchman named Uli loading their machine guns. Uli even finds the time to enjoy a candy bar. John is still upstairs watching these cops run headfirst into trouble.
You macho assholes, no! No!
Theo is in the security room watching the police move in. He picks up his radio.
All right, you guys, this might not be the time, but did anyone feel like Hans was putting out a vibe earlier? I was really picking up a vibe. All right, we'll talk about it. Listen, 'twas the night before Christmas, and all through the house, not a creature was stirring, except for those four assholes coming in the rear! Stand in 2x2 formation!
Back in the parking lot, a cop signals to Dwayne that they're ready.
Kick ass!
Three of the policemen approach the lobby door. All of a sudden, bullets start flying out from an upper floor window.
They're shooting at them!
They're shooting at the lights.
One by one, the lights go out.
Hey, they're shooting at the lights.
The policemen light up a blowtorch, hoping to burn through the lobby door. Hans observes from upstairs.
Don't get impatient. Just wound them.
Chief Dwayne Robinson has turned on a dime, now yelling at one of the SWAT officers.
Pull them back! They're sitting ducks up there!
Instead, the SWAT officer calls in a SWAT car. Inside the lobby, we see Uli and Eddie take aim. They fire, wounding all three officers. The cops scatter away in a panic.
Oh, what do we have here? Looks like the cops have what anyone would call definitely an RV in the southeast corner.
In a panic, two henchmen wheel a rocket launcher into an elevator.
Get over there!
The henchmen set the rocket launcher right next to a window and start putting it together. The SWAT car shows no signs of stopping. It barrels towards the door, but is stopped by its greatest weakness, a flight of stairs. The henchmen seize their opportunity, launching a missile out of the window. One shot is all it takes to blow the whole car to smithereens.
Oh my God, the quarterback is toast. Big fan of sports references.
Hans observes from upstairs. He doesn't look satisfied.
Hit it again.
John hears this on the radio.
Hans, you motherfucker! You made your point, now let him pull back.
Thank you, Mr. Cowboy. I'll take it under advisement, but oh, hit it again.
Thinking on his feet, John runs over to an elevator and starts attacking it with an axe he finds by the fire alarm. Another missile is fired, blowing the car up a second time. John props open the elevator door with the axe. He looks down the elevator shaft. The drop looks like it never ends.
Fuck me.
John looks at the C4 explosives he has.
Fuck it.
He puts the explosives on a chair and then ties a computer desktop to the chair.
Let's see you take this under advisement, jerkweed.
Let's bring jerkweed back.
Wow.
I've called so many people motherfuckers. Like 20 people, and then I say jerkweed?
He takes his homemade bomb over to the elevator door.
Geronimo, motherfucker! The next line!
The bomb drops for what seems like forever. When it finally lands, the explosions destroy the floor the henchmen are on, instantly killing them. Hostages and policemen jump at the sound of the explosion. It's so powerful that the fire comes all the way back up the elevator shaft. John has to quickly dive away. Fritz runs into Hans's office.
They used our artillery on us.
Now it's Asian. I'm sorry.
Yeah, it wasn't even the Asian guy.
Oh, yeah.
They used our artillery on us.
Idiot. It's not the police. It's him.
Outside, Al and Dwayne survey the carnage.
Holy shit.
Thornburg can't believe what he's seen. Neither can his cameraman or assistant.
My God, tell me you got that. Eat your heart out, Channel 5.
Al's radio crackles to life.
Al, pal, do you copy?
Are you all right?
Yeah. I'm fine.
What was that?
You know that plastic explosive I told you about?
Yeah.
That wasn't it. Is the building on fire?
No, but it's going to need a paint job and a shitload of screen doors.
All right. Starting page 48 of 80.
Way to slow it down.
Yeah, let's slow it. Let's we're really coasting right now.
Our spotters say you got two with that blast.
Where the fuck are you? Oh, there you are. Chief Robinson sees Al talking on the radio.
Is that him? Is that him?
Yes, sir.
Give me that. Now you listen to me, mister. I don't know who the heck you think you are or what you're doing, but you just destroyed a building. Now, we do not want your help. Is that clear? We don't want your help. I've got 100 people down here, and they're covered with glass.
Glass? Who gives a shit about glass? Who the fuck is this?
This is Deputy Chief of Police Dwayne T. Robinson, and I am in charge of this situation.
Oh, you're in charge. Well, I got some bad news for you, Dwayne. From up here, it doesn't look like you're in charge of jack shit.
You listen to me, you little asshole.
Asshole? Asshole? I'm not the one that just got butt-fucked on national TV, Dwayne.
Oh.
Now listen to me, jerkwad. You're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem. Quit being part of the fucking problem and put the other guy back on.
Chief Robinson, having been reduced to a little bitch boy, hands the radio back to Powell. He messed with the bull and he got the horns.
Hey, Roy, that was funny as shit, man. How you feeling?
Pretty fucking unappreciated, pal.
Hey, look, I love you. So do a lot of other guys. So hang in there, man. You hear me? You hang in there.
Yeah. Thanks, partner.
Amongst the hostages, Holly catches Ellis sniffing up a thimble of cocaine.
Oh, fuck me.
What are you even doing?
Cocaine. I'm tired of sitting here waiting to see who is going to be the first person to get killed. Them or your fucking husband.
What are you even going to do?
Well, hey, babe. I negotiate $1 million deals for breakfast. I think I can handle this Euro trash.
He tries to speak German with one of the henchmen.
Du's big...
No, that's not good. No.
Auf Wiedersehen.
Oh!
The line's there for you. You could read it.
I sprechen Sie talk, huh?
Jesus Christ. In Hans's office, Carl and Hans are arguing.
If you listen to me, he would already be neutralized already.
I don't want neutral. I want dead.
We hear a knock at the door. It's Ellis.
Hope I'm not interrupting.
What does he want?
It's not what I want. It's what I can give you, boobs.
Gross.
Carl thinks about shooting Ellis. Hans shakes his head.
Look, let's be straight, okay? It's obvious you're not some dumb schmuck up here to steal purses. Am I right or am I right?
You're very perceptive.
I watched 60 Minutes. Seeing you, I said to myself, these guys are professional.
Correct.
They're motivated.
Uh-huh.
They're happening, sure. i.e. they want something, babe. Now, personally, I couldn't care less about your politics. Maybe you pissed off some... You're pissed off at some camel jockeys. Maybe Whoa. It's the Heaps. You know, just classic 80s stuff, you know? It's none of my business. I figure you're here to negotiate. Am I right, or am I right, or am I right, or am I right, or am I right?
You're amazingly racist. You. I'm German, by the way. And I wouldn't think any of those things. You figure this out already, though. Congratulations.
Ellis laughs his famous laugh.
Oh, man, I spit beer on my script. Hey, business is business. You use a gun, I use a fountain pen and cocaine. What's the difference? Let's put it in my terms. You're in a hostile takeover. You grab us for some green. But what you didn't expect was some poison pill running around the building. Am I right? Hans, Bubby, I'm your white knight, baby.
I must have missed 60 Minutes. What the fuck are you talking about?
Ellis pats Carl on the shoulder.
That guy that's upstairs fucking things up. I can give him to you, baby.
Ellis puts on the biggest salesman smile of his life. Outside, Al hears John groaning from the radio.
Roy, you all right?
Yeah. I just took a bite of a 1,000-year-old Twinkie.
Should have told me. I got something fresh out here.
What did I put in this thing? Ugh.
Sugar, enriched flour, hydrogenated vegetable oil, poly-something 860, and yellow dye number 5. Just everything a growing boy needs.
Polysterone.
Yeah, that works.
How many kids you got, Al?
Well, as a matter of fact, my wife was working on our first. I mean, if you don't count the one that went upstairs and never came back down. All right, some of y'all old enough to get that one. Thank you. How about you, cowboy? You got any kids back on your ranch?
Yeah, 2. Sure hope I can see him swinging on the jungle gym with my pal Al Powell Jr. someday.
Well, now, that's a date. But you're going to have to bring the ice cream.
Oh, man. Theo, what does that mean? Read into that. Is that? Man, oh, man.
It's just fucking
that
ice
means
cream,
we're looking
man.
For something creamy.
Yeah. It's a kid's party, man.
Hot, man. Hans has been listening this whole time.
Touching, cowboy. Touching. Or should I call you Mr. McClane? Mr. Officer John McClane of the New York Police Department. I know everything.
Thornburg has also been listening the whole time. He looks at his assistant.
Get on the phone with Harry in New York. Come on, baby. Move, move.
Did you just call me Mr. Officer? Sister Teresa used to call me Mr. McClane in the third grade. My friends call me John. The guy down at the corner calls me Eddie. You're none of those, shithead.
I have someone who wants to talk to you. A very special friend who is with you at the party tonight.
John's heart drops to his stomach. It's totally Holly.
Hey, John boy, baby!
Ellis?
Yeah. Now listen, John. They gave me a few minutes to try and talk some fucking sense into you. I know you think you're doing your job, John, and I appreciate that. But you're just dragging this thing out. Now look, no one's getting out of here until these guys talk to the LA police, and that just ain't gonna happen until you stop messing up their work. Capisce?
Ellis, what have you told them?
I told them we were old friends and you're my guest at the party.
Ellis, you shouldn't be doing this.
Tell me about it. All right, John, listen. I want you to tell them where the detonators are. I know people are listening. I want the detonators or they're gonna kill me.
He assures things Hans are going well with a thumbs up.
Hey, John, did you hear me?
Yeah. Yeah, I hear you.
Hey, John, I think you should get with the program a little, huh? The police are here now. It's their problem. Now tell these guys where the detonators are so no one else gets hurt. You know I'm putting my life on the line for you, pal.
Ellis, listen to me very carefully.
John.
Shut up, Ellis! Shut your mouth. Put Hans back on the line. Hans, this shithead does not know what kind of man you are, but I do.
Good. Then you'll give us what we want and save your friend's life. You're not part of that equation this time. You realize that.
Hey, what am I, a method actor, Hans? Put away the gun. This is radio. It's not television.
Hans, this asshole is not my friend. I just met him tonight. I don't know him. Jesus Christ, Ellis. These people are gonna kill you. Tell him you don't know me.
Ellis laughs his famous laugh.
John, how could you say this after all these years? You know, John? 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 I say John. Oh, wait. John? 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 John?
Ellis looks John. At Hans and laughs at the situation. Hans lifts up his gun, and Ellis takes a sip of his drink. From the other end of his radio, John hears one gunshot, along with the screams of the hostages! Hans walks out of his office and faces the hostages. He holds up his radio so John can hear the chaos. Hans
says,
"You hear that? Talk to me! Where are my detonators? Where are they? Or shall I shoot another one? Sooner or later, I might get to someone you do care about."
You shot Ellis?
Yes.
Cool.
It was my pleasure.
Thanks.
You go. Do have more to say.
Well, I thought he saw my head nod, which would indicate to continue, but go fuck yourself, Hans.
Oh!
Outside, Dwayne and Al can't believe what just happened.
Did you hear that? You just let one guy die, man. You just gave him up. Give me that headset.
Christ, man. Can't you see what's happening? Can't you read between the lines? He did everything he could to save him. If he gave himself up, they'd both be dead right now.
No way. No way, man. They'd be talking to us. Listen,
You tell this partner of yours to stay the hell out of this from now on. You hear me? Because if he doesn't, I'm going to nail him. Boy, I'm really going to nail his ass down. Believe me.
That sounded slightly gay, man. But this man is hurt. He is alone, tired, and hasn't seen diddly squat from anybody down here. Are you going to stand there and tell me he's going to give a damn about what you do to him if he makes it out of this, out of there alive? Why don't you wake up and smell what you shoveling?
You listen to me, Sergeant. Anytime you want to go home, you consider yourself dismissed.
No, sir. You couldn't drag me away.
The radio crackles to life.
Attention, police. Attention, police.
This is Sergeant Al Winslow.
Oh, give me that!
Dwayne takes the radio from Al.
This is Chief Dwayne T. Robinson. Who is this?
Oh, this is Hans Gruber. I'm assuming you realize the futility of direct action against me. We have no wish for further loss of life.
Well, what is it you do wish for, Mr. Gruber?
Were you practicing that all day?
Coming at you hard.
I have comrades in arms around the world languishing in prisons. The American State Department enjoys rattling its saber in its own ends. Now it can rattle them for me. The following people are to be released from their captors. In Northern Ireland, the 7 members of the New Provo Front. In Canada, the 5 imprisoned leaders of the Liberté de Quebec. In Sri Lanka, the 9 members of the Asian Dawn Movement. These are all accents that were featured in my henchmen.
Asian Dawn Movement?
I read about it in Time Magazine. When these revolutionary brothers and sisters are free, the hostages in this building will be taken to the roof and they will accompany us in the helicopters to Los Angeles New International Airport. I am losing it. Where they will be given further instructions. You have 2 hours to comply.
Wait a minute, Mr. Gruber. This is crazy. I don't have the authority. I can't authorize that. 2 hours is not enough. Hello? 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 Hello?
Hello?
Hello?
Hello?
Hi.
Hello?
Hello?
Yellow.
Hello?
This is a private channel.
Yellow.
Back in the office, Carl and Hans go over the game plan.
Do you really think they'll try to do it?
Who cares? Theo, are we on schedule?
1 more to go, and then it's up to you, my man. And you better be right, because it looks like this is the last. This last one's gonna take a miracle.
It's Christmas, Theo. It's the time for miracles. So be of good cheer and call me when you hit the last lock.
Hans hangs up.
Carl will hunt the little shit down and get those fucking detonators.
Fritz is checking on the employees.
I'll check the explosives. You just get the detonators.
Upstairs, John is taking a minute to rest.
Hey, pal, you out there?
I'm here, John. I'm here.
You gotta believe me. There was nothing I could do.
Well, it's gonna be both our asses if you're wrong.
I hear you. You catch that bullshit Hans was running? Doesn't make sense.
Hey, don't ask me, man. I'm just a desk jockey who was on my way home when you rang.
Well, you drove that car, I figured you for the streets.
In my youth, partner. In my youth.
Outside, we see Chief Robinson on the phone.
No, no. Asian Dawn. Dawn. D-A-W-N.
A police officer walks up to Dwayne and whispers something into his ear.
The FBI? Is here now? Oh, okay.
Want a breath mint?
Dwayne walks over to the 2 FBI agents. He sticks his hand out for handshakes, but he's left hanging.
Hey, how you doing, man?
I'm Agent Johnson. This is Special Agent Johnson.
How are you doing?
No relation.
I'm Dwayne Robinson, LAPD. I'm in charge here.
Not anymore.
We cut to Hans walking through a dark, unconstructed floor. After seeing that the detonators are not there, he turns to see John McClane pointing a machine gun at him.
Hi there. How you doing?
Hans, thinking on his feet, becomes an American coward.
Oh, please, God, no! You're one of them, aren't you? You're one of them? Oh, no, don't kill me, bruh! Please, don't kill me, don't kill me, don't kill me, please, please!
Whoa, 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 relax, relax, I'm not gonna hurt you. I'm not gonna hurt you. The fuck you doing up here? Who are you looking for?
I managed to get out of there and, well, I was trying to get out on the roof and see if I could, like, signal for help, you know? It's right over there. Why don't you just come and help?
Hans tries to lead him away. John stays right where he is.
Whoa, whoa, forget the roof.
Oh, come on.
I said forget the roof. They got people all over. Come on. You want to stay alive? You stay with me.
Hans gives him a look that basically says, I can't believe you fell for that. Outside, agents Johnson & Johnson, no tear shampoo, walk with a purpose. Robinson is trying to keep up.
Well, the best we can figure it is that we got 30, maybe 35 hostages up there. Probably on the 30th floor, maybe, I don't know, 7 or 8 terrorists up there.
Sounds like an A7 scenario.
Thank you. We'll handle it from here. When we commandeer your men, we'll try to let you know.
Aren't you forgetting something?
Such as?
What about John McClane? He's the reason we have the information we have up until now. He's also the reason you're facing 7 terrorists instead of 12.
He's inside? Well, who is he?
Well, he might be a cop. I don't know. We're checking on that.
Is he one of yours?
No. No way.
Upstairs, John pulls out his cigarette. He has 2 left. He looks at Hans.
You smoke?
Hans smiles with 1 lip.
Yeah.
John hands Hans a cigarette.
Thanks. You don't work for Nakatomi. And if you're not one of them...
I'm a cop from New York City.
Whoa, New York?
New York, yeah. Yeah, I got invited to this Christmas party by mistake. Who knew?
Hans tries an American laugh. He looks at John's dirty bare feet and laughs even harder. John notices and smiles.
Guess it's better than being caught with your pants down, huh? Like with your dick out and shit? I'm John McClane.
Clay. Bill Clay.
You know how to use a handgun, Bill?
I spent a weekend at a combat ranch. You know that game where with like the guns and they shoot like red paint? Probably seems kind of stupid to you.
John offers his fucking gun to Hans Gruber.
Well, Bill, time for the real thing.
Hans can't believe this is happening.
Whoa!
All you gotta do is pull the trigger.
John starts to walk away. Hans stays in place and points his gun at John.
Put down the gun and give me my detonators.
Well, well, well. Hans.
Oh, shoot, you knew it was me? Crazy. Put it down now.
Pretty tricky with that accent.
It was pretty good.
Yeah, you ought to be on fucking TV, man. But what do you want with the detonators, Hans? I mean, I already used all the explosives. Or did I?
Oh, so coy.
By now, John has walked right up to Hans' face.
I'm going to count to 3.
Yeah, like you did with Takagi.
Hans pulls the trigger. The trigger clicks.
Oops.
Hans pulls the trigger 4 more times.
Damn, 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 damn.
You dipshit. No bullets, huh? Do you think I'm a fucking stupid face? Hans?
John takes the gun. The elevator dings behind him.
USA.
Fritz and Carl emerge from the elevator. Carl ducks out of the way, but Fritz is hit by John's immediate gunfire. John runs away, firing his machine gun the whole time. Carl keeps firing at him, breaking several glass partitions. John ducks into one of the offices. After ducking below a desk, he shoots another henchman in the shins. He then corners Carl behind a desk of his own. Hans sees all the glass on the floor and has an epiphany.
Carl, was machst du in deiner Freizeit?
Carl doesn't understand because there's a 90% chance that wasn't real German.
It was. It means what do you do in your free time?
What did that translate to in German?
Shoot the glass.
There we go. Hans and Carl then proceed to shoot up every partition and window on the floor, glass flying all around.
Jesus Christ.
John's machine gun is out of bullets. All he has is his pistol. He sees the only thing separating him from a nearby exit is a floor covered in glass. Who gives a shit about glass now, John? Carl sets off a flashbang grenade just for good measure. Hans looks into John's bag to find the detonators.
Well, Carl, back to business.
We cut to Thornburg sitting in his car. His assistant eagerly walks up with a manila folder.
You got something? Tell me you got something.
She happens to have everything you could possibly know about John McClane. Back amongst the hostages, we see Hans arrive from the elevator and throw the bag of detonators to Uli.
Go to work.
Holly McClane's eyes follow Carl, who looks like he's about to explode. He takes his machine gun and smashes a glass table with it.
That man looks really pissed.
He's still alive.
What?
Only John can drive somebody that crazy.
Back upstairs, we see John crawling into a bathroom, grunting in pain with every move. His feet leave a snail trail of blood behind him. In the vault room, Theo has finally reached the last lock.
Honey, baby. You better heat up that miracle, hon. We just broke through number six, and the electromagnetic came down like a fucking anvil.
Oh, honey, have a look at what our friends outside are doing, and I'll be right up.
Ooh.
In the bathroom, John is trying so hard to find the strength to go on. His radio crackles to life.
John McClane, you still with us?
Yeah. All things being equal, I'd rather be in Philadelphia. Chalk up two more bad guys.
Well, the boys down here will be glad to hear that, especially since we've got you making it all the way to the end of this thing in the death pool.
What kind of odds am I getting?
Ah, shit, 20 to 1 from some of us. But you know what, you got a pool going on you.
God damn, I didn't realize that was the actual next line.
Well,
okay.
Put me down for 20. I'm good for it.
John pulls a shard of glass out of his foot.
Hey, Al. Powell. My pal. You got flat feet?
The hell are you talking about, man?
Something had to get you off the streets.
What's the matter? You don't think moving papers across a desk is a noble effort for a cop?
No.
Fuck
so
you
quick.
Too then. But I had an accident.
The way you drive, I can see why. What'd you do? Run over the captain's foot with your car, you dipshit?
No, I shot a kid. He was 13 years old. It was dark. I couldn't see him. He had a ray gun. Looked real enough. You know, when you're a rookie, they can teach you everything about being a cop, except how to live with a mistake. Anyway, since he was black, I knew I wouldn't get fired. But I just couldn't bring myself to draw my gun on anybody ever again.
Hey, Argyle, is that racist?
Don't put this on me.
It looked like a real enough ray gun? Oh, man, I'm sorry, man.
Hey, man, how could you know?
I still feel like shit anyway.
Well, then this won't matter. The LAPD is not calling the shots around here anymore.
The feds?
You got it.
Hans and Theo are looking at the security cameras, watching the FBI agents outside.
You see those little hot boys in the suits down there? I don't know who they are.
Oh, it's the FBI. They're ordering the others to cut the building's power, regular as clockwork.
Or a time lock. Huh?
Okay, is that a saying? Precisely. The circuits that can't be cut are cut automatically in response to a terrorist attack. You ask for miracles, I give you the FBI.
Outside, we see agents Magic Johnson and Dwayne The Rock Johnson arguing with a maintenance worker.
I said I want the frickin' thing shut down. I don't give a shit what your problem is. I don't give two shits about a switch. I want the building out! Lose the grid or lose your dang job!
Oh, goodness.
He's mad.
The Nakatomi Plaza becomes a tower of darkness. We cut to the bathroom. The emergency lights turn on as John grabs his radio.
Al, talk to me. What's going on here?
Ask the FBI. They've got the Universal Terrorist Playbook, and they're running it step by step.
Back in the vault room, we hear the heavy thud of a vault door opening.
It's gonna go. It's gonna go. Yeah, it's gonna go.
Oh, yeah.
The vault is open. $40 million in negotiable bearer bonds. It's beautiful.
Merry Christmas. We should all kiss.
Outside, Dwayne is trailing his new FBI friends.
Those bastards are probably pissing in their pants right now.
The mayor's gonna have my ass.
Hans and Theo ransack the vaults. Old armor, priceless works of art, so much money. Outside, Al is in full-on roast mode.
What are we supposed to do now? Arrest them for not paying their electric bill?
We shut them down. We'll let them sweat for a while, then we'll give them helicopters. Right up the ass.
Johnson picks up a radio.
This is Agent Johnson. No, the other one. I want that air support ready to lift off in 5 minutes. Damn right. Fully armed. We are on the way.
Hans interrupts.
I wish to talk to the FBI.
This is Special Agent Johnson of the FBI. The State Department has arranged for the release of your comrades. Helicopters are en route, as you requested.
I hear you. We'll be ready.
Shoot, sorry, ordering a drink. All right. Johnson hangs up.
Well, by the time he figures out what hit him, he'll be in a body bag.
Hans hangs up and looks at Theo.
When they touch down and we blow the roof, they'll spend a month sifting through the bodies and rubble. By the time they figure out what went wrong, we'll be sitting on a beach earning 20%.
In the bathroom, John is struggling to walk again. One foot is crudely bandaged and the other one can't hold all of his weight.
Pal. Yo, Powell. You got a minute?
I'm here, John.
Listen, man. I'm starting to get a bad feeling up here. I think it was a fucking Twinkie. I think Twinkie's gonna get me. I've blown up half a building. I've got cuts in my feet. There's fucking Twinkies. I think they poisoned the Twinkie, man. Listen, I want you to do something for me. I want you to find my wife. Don't ask me how. I want you to tell her something. I want you to tell her that it took me a little while to figure out what a jerk I've been. A jerk weed, someone might say. The way things started panning out for her, I should have been more supportive, and I should have been behind her more.
Yeah.
Tell her that she's the best thing that ever happened to a bum like me. She's heard me say I love you like 7 or 8 times. She never heard me say I'm sorry. When you tell her that, Al, tell her that John McClane, her husband, said he was sorry. Okay? You got that, man?
Yeah, I got it, John. But you can tell her yourself. You just watch your ass and you'll make it out of there. You hear me?
Yeah, I guess it's up to the man upstairs now.
John has an epiphany.
John? Yo, John.
The fuck you doing upstairs, Hans?
John!
Al, listen. Just lay off for a little while, man. I gotta go check on something.
Back at Holly's home, Thornburg is trying to get through the front door. He's got a story to break. Paulina is refusing to let him through.
1 minute. That's all I'm asking for. 1 minute.
Hey, no.
Thornburg turns to his cameraman.
All right, look, miss. Let me in right now, or I'm going to call ICE. Comprende?
Whew.
Sure would be a shame if someone had to make America great again around here.
Oh, God.
Look. This could be the last time these kids speak to their parents.
We cut to the 40th floor. John is limping towards the roof.
What are you doing, Hans? What are you doing?
John looks up into an open ceiling panel. Inside the ceiling is enough explosives to blow the whole roof off.
Jesus, Mary, Mother of God.
John frantically pulls out his radio.
Ow, ow, listen to me. It's a double cross. The whole roof is built. It's going to blow up, man. It's all fucking wired, man.
John stops and turns to see the barrel of a machine gun.
John, come in.
Thank you. John stops and turns to see the barrel of a gun, and then Al says that line, and Carl grabs John's radio and smashes it on the floor.
We are both professionals, but this is personal.
John shoves the gun out of the way and punches Carl in the face. He shoves Carl into a big pile of barrels and starts punching like a madman. Carl blocks a punch and returns with one of his own, knocking John off of his feet. In Hans's office, Eddie is looking out the window.
They're coming, man. The choppers are coming.
That's your southern accent?
Oh, wait. I'll take it again. Let's run it right back. They're coming, man. The goddamn choppers are coming.
What, now you're from Georgia?
Whirlybirds.
I don't know.
Okay. Well, time to gather your flock.
Fucking choppers, huh?
Suddenly, the TV catches his attention. Thornburg is interviewing little Lucy McLean.
Now, your mom and dad are very important people. They're very brave people. So there's something you'd like to say to them while they're watching.
Come home, Eleven.
Hans looks at Holly. Hans looks at Holly. Then he looks down at the face-down family portrait. He turns it up and everything adds up. He looks at Holly and pulls out his gun.
Mrs. McLean, how nice to meet your McLeantance.
Oh! Oh, shit! Ah! Oh, man!
Stand up.
Uh-huh. If you have a drink, drink to that.
That was...
He fires two shots into the air and the hostages panic.
To the roof! Everyone!
He grabs Holly. She's a very important hostage now. Meanwhile, Carl is repeatedly kicking John in the face and torso. John reaches for his pistol, only to be kicked again. Carl crane kicks him into a pile of pipes. John pulls him down, though, and gets the upper hand. He starts to furiously slam Carl's head onto the floor.
You know, I heard your brother squeal when I broke his fucking neck.
That's rude. That's my goddamn brother.
It's not like you don't know how to read. It's like you don't know words. Like, you know how to read, but every word is
new.
So,
like, there was...
We cut to the inside of a helicopter.
So what do you figure? I figure we take out the terrorists, lose 20-25% of them hostages, tops.
I think I can live with that.
We see Uli rushing the hostages up towards the roof. Hans leads Holly to the vault room.
Theo, a little bonus for us. Please sit down. Sit down, you know where.
He forces Holly to the ground.
Hey!
A policeman's wife might come in handy.
He picks up a radio.
McLean, I have some news for you, McLean.
Back to the fight. Carl pushes John away from him and grabs the pistol on the ground.
Bop.
As John is trying to exit through a door, Carl pops one bullet into his shoulder.
Bop.
Carl follows John into the room, but is immediately kicked in the face. John jumps onto Carl.
Motherfucker, I'll kill you.
We see Hans quickly hauling money into a bag.
After all your posturing, all your little speeches, you're nothing but a common thief.
Hans quickly gets up in her face.
Oh, I'm an exceptional thief, I'll have you know. And since I'm moving up to kidnapping, you should be more polite.
Back to the fight. Carl kicks John onto a flight of stairs.
Bop, bop, bop.
He goes for a judo chop, but John blocks it with a headbutt. John is still finding time to talk some shit.
Motherfucker, I'm gonna kill you. I'm gonna cook you, and then I'm gonna fucking eat you.
Weird.
Carl is forcing John up the stairs when John wraps a chain around Carl's neck. He pulls another chain, hoisting Carl up into midair and hanging him to his death. John quickly grabs the pistol and runs away. Outside, Al and Dwayne are watching the helicopters fly in.
I don't like this, Sarge.
We see Schlong and Donk, Johnson and Johnson riding in one of the helicopters. They are coming in hot.
Yeehaw! Just like fucking Saigon, eh, Slick?
I was a junior high, you fucking dickhead.
Uli finally ushers the last hostage onto the roof. As he heads back downstairs, John appears, pumping him full of lead. The hostages panic as a bloody topless man emerges from the stairs.
Where's Holly? Where's Holly? Where's Holly Gennaro? Where is she? Where's Holly?
They took her.
Where?
The vault.
Where's the vault?
13th floor.
The helicopters have finally reached the roof. John calmly addresses the hostages.
Get downstairs, all of you. The whole fucking roof is wired to blow. Get down. Get the fuck downstairs.
There's no reaching these people. John shoots his machine gun into the air and scares them away. Suddenly, gunfire comes from the helicopters, forcing everyone to scatter.
Fuck you! I was shooting at them to get them down. not at the helicopter. I'm on your side, assholes.
John finds a compartment that reads for emergency use. He opens it up and starts unraveling a fire hose. He then begins to wrap it around his waist.
Ah, John, the fuck you doing, man? How you fucking get into this shit, man?
Inside, Eddie sees all the hostages running back in.
Oh, there's something wrong. They're coming back down.
Blow the roof.
But Carl's up there.
Oh, just blow the roof.
All right. On the roof, John is making peace with his God.
I know I have said this 1,000 times, good Lord, but I promise I will never even think about going up in a tall building again.
He looks down.
Oh, God, please don't let me die.
Just as John jumps, Hans flips the switch and blows the whole roof to hell. John screams the whole way down. The wheel holding the fire hose is stuck on a tiny corner of the building. John tries a couple of times to kick the window he's in front of. His feet are too bloody and slippery. John rappels back and fires a whole round of bullets into the window. After breaking through, we see that the wheel holding the hose is now plummeting to the ground. The hose is slowly pulling John towards the open window. John is just barely able to free himself. The helicopters that had been attacking John fall to the ground, exploding on the way down.
Holy Christ. Looks like we're gonna need some more FBI guys, I guess.
Inside, John is drenched in the water from the emergency sprinkler system. In the parking garage, Argyle sees Theo walking into a truck bed.
The fuck is going on? Oh, God.
Yeah. Theo drives a van out of the truck bed. Upstairs, John is looking around when he hears Holly's voice.
What are you going to do? Sit here while the building falls down around your ears?
Real sass on that. We cut to John checking his machine gun.
Dang it!
He takes the few remaining bullets from the machine gun and puts them in his pistol. He's got 2 bullets, 2 shots, 2 opportunities, mom's spaghetti. He looks over and sees a cart of Christmas packaging equipment, mostly wrapping paper and tape. In the garage, we see Argyle's limo slowly creeping. As soon as Theo's van is in his sights, he charges at full speed, totaling both vehicles. Argyle jumps right out of the car and runs to the van. Before Theo can do anything, he's knocked out in one punch.
Hans.
Inside, one of the henchmen is running. John's fist comes from around the corner and knocks him out.
Hans! I want that cigarette back.
Hans and Eddie look up from their work.
Paul?
Hans then pulls out a pistol and pulls Holly to his side. This is the first time Holly's seen John since the shit went down.
Jesus!
Hi, honey.
John keeps walking forward, making Hans and Holly back up.
So that's what this is all about, a fucking robbery?
Oh, put down the gun.
Why'd you have to go and nuke the whole building, Hans? I think I did that.
I nicked the bottom.
You do.
Part.
You nicked the boat.
Yeah, I blame you.
Well, when you steal
continuing page 76 of 80. So close. So fucking close.
Oh no! Now it's time to take our time. When you steal $600, you can disappear. Mm-hmm. Yeah. When you steal $600 million, they will find you. Unless they think you're already dead, put down the gun.
John drops the machine gun. Holly can't believe it. Eddie reaches for his gun.
Hey-o.
Nine! This one's mine.
See.
John puts his hand over his head.
You got me.
Still the cowboy, Mr. McLean. You Americans, all alike. But this time, John Wayne does not walk off into the sunset with Grace Kelly.
That was Gary Cooper, asshole.
Enough jokes.
You could have been a pretty good cowboy yourself, Hans.
Thank you.
Yeah.
What was it you said to me before? Yippee-ki-yay, motherfucker.
Hans points the gun at John, but John starts laughing. This confuses Hans, but it also delights him. He starts laughing, just laughing and laughing and laughing. Even Eddie starts laughing. Holly doesn't find this funny at all. But John has something taped to his back, a loaded gun.
Holly!
Holly ducks and John shoots Hans in the chest.
No!
He then turns to Eddie and shoots him in the head.
Not me. No. God damn it.
John, like a true cowboy, blows the smoke coming from his pistol.
Happy trails, Hans.
Hans, still holding Holly, stumbles through a window. Holly starts screaming, thinking she might fall out. John rushes to her. As John tries to pry Hans' fingers from his wife's arms, Hans points his pistol at John. But John removes his wife's Rolex, forcing Hans to slip off and hit the ground like a sack of potatoes.
Boo!
God, I hope that's not a hostage.
John and Holly embrace, never happier to see each other. Ambulances rush to the scene as John and Holly walk out the front door. John immediately sees Al. They stare at each other, and considering their previous talks, this is the least gay their friendship has ever been. They embrace, laughing and reveling in the joy of survival.
My pal, Al, pal, this is my wife. This is my gal, pal, Al, pal, meet my gal, pal. This is my gal, pal, Holly, Holly Genero.
Holly shakes Al's hand.
Holly McLean.
Hello, Holly. I now see why you left this motherfucker. But you got yourself a good man. You take care of him.
McLean, I want a debriefing, goddammit. You got some things to answer for, mister. Ellis was murdered for one thing, property damage and interfering with police business.
John is about to punch Dwayne in the face when we hear a vicious scream.
Yeah!
From the... From the front door comes an armed and bloody Carl.
What's up?
Everyone recoils in horror while also going, wait, how did he not die?
Tried to choke me. Got a thick neck.
He points his gun at John. John is unarmed, but Carl is nailed with 4 bullets, hopefully killing him for sure this time.
Gop, gop.
Oh, my goodness. The camera turns to reveal the shooter. It's none other than Sergeant Al Powell. Looks like he'll be back. Yeah. Looks like he'll be back to shooting children in no time.
I'm even going to try to include some white ones this time.
Yeah. Argyle's limo crashes through the gate of the garage. Al draws his gun again, so ready to shoot a kid, but John reins him in.
It's all right. This one's with me.
Oh. What do you mean, this one?
It's just one of them.
My man.
Mr. McClane. Mr. McClane!
Before we know it, John has a mic in his face.
Now that it's all over, after this incredible ordeal, what are your feelings?
Holly doesn't hesitate to punch Thornburg right in the nose. Thornburg looks to the cameraman.
Did you get that?
John and Holly get into the limo. Argyle closes the door.
If this is their idea of Christmas, I gotta be here for New Year's.
The end! Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for being here. Before we end this, give it up for your whole cast. Oh my God. We got Rand Barnicle, we got Chris Weir, Phil Pointer, Grant Stiles, Carl Spaeth, Alex Stone, Logan Lotzenizer, Butch Wesley, Amber Falter, Billy DeVoy, Zach Weika, Brittany Catanzaro, Jeremy Johnson, Goodrich Kumar, John Schreck, Dave Powell, Molly Hartzell, and Alicia Galina. This was the best. We'll see you next Christmas.
Keep it going for Josh.
Your narrator.
There we go, technology. Guys, thanks for coming out to Miracle at the Overlook Lodge. Give it up again for this amazing cast. Thank you so much for coming out here. If you love this, Wednesday at our sister bar, the Video Archive, we are showing Star Wars Holiday Special, so you guys can come celebrate Life Day. I promise it'll be better than The Last Jedi. And then, apparently it's a decisive statement nowadays. I didn't realize it was. And then New Year's Eve, if you don't have New Year's Eve plans, neither of our bars have covers. Here we're doing Return to the Gold Room, which is our annual 1940s Gold Room celebration. And then over at the Video Archive, we're doing Return to Wonderland, Alice in Wonderland themed New Year's Eve over there. So if you guys don't have plans, free champagne, some food, and some awesome things happening, and follow us on Facebook. Give it up for this cast one more time.
What's up, boys?